This weekend, of course, we're celebrating Labor Day, and it's a sign the season is changing. But I don't know about you, if you looked outside, it doesn't look like the sign of a season changing, right? In places like P-Town and Myrtle Beach, it means less crowds and less revenue for local businesses, where they actually experience a fall and a winter. In Dallas, it seems we only have two seasons. Summer, which we're a mile from the sun, and cowboy season. If you're not a Cowboys fan, I'm sorry. If you are a Cowboys fan, I'm really sorry. We're in a rebuilding year since 1996, which by the way, that's when I got out of the military. It's been a while since we've been to a Super Bowl. There are parts of the country that do experience all four seasons. I've lived in some of them. In Texas, we get to experience all four seasons in one day. So I guess we have it all right here. You don't have to go anywhere. As I reflect on the end of summer, and I'm reminded that there are also four seasons of our spiritual life. There's a fall and a summer, a spring and a winter. The spiritual seasons are a lot like Texas weather. They don't go in order. You can go from a summer to a winter in a single moment. And so we must all be prepared for those seasons. There is much to be learned from these seasons, even the most challenging ones. As we look at scripture in the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes 3, 1 through 8, this was written by what was one of the wisest men in the Bible, Solomon. And these were his writings. For everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. It is a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together to rebuild. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love, a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. Now, if that sounds vaguely familiar, you may remember the song from the Birds in 1965, Turn, Turn, Turn. But if you're a child of the 80s, you'll remember this Time magazine TV ad that played songs to the events around the world recorded by Time magazine. Now, I don't know about you, but I fell in love with these commercials, and I convinced my parents to not only buy the magazine, but also to get the travel-on bag that you got along with it, which came with an alarm clock. And I still, my husband can attest, still have Time magazine in our home to this day. Now, little did I know as I was reading these passages about the world, and by the way, I was a nerdy kid to be reading Time magazine at 10 years old, but oh well. I was an old soul. Little did I know that as I thumbed through the pages of Time magazine that my life too would be on the cover of a Time magazine. I had joined the Army and served with the 82nd Airborne Division. The Army is not like the commercials. Some of it is. We're not running into battle every 5 minutes. Most of our days are pretty routine and almost boring. And you can easily forget why you joined in the first place. And that was to defend our country against moments like this one. Let me take you back to September of 1994. The mission of the 82nd Airborne Division was to be wheels up and taking off within 18 hours of notification. Imagine, if you will, 14,000 paratroopers, tanks, Humvees, and artillery loaded up into a military operation and dropped from 2,000 feet in the air. If you're the enemy, that can be kind of scary. We can sustain ourselves for up to 14 days without any outside support. We are a military within the military. That summer day in September went from a summer day into a winter storm. And I had to ask myself the question, was I willing to kill for my country? Was I willing to die for my country? Since this was a time before cell phones, there was very little communication coming out of Fort Bragg. They literally ripped the payphones out of the walls at Pope Air Force Base, so no one could make any phone calls. And we kept the media at a distance, but there's only so far you can push back CNN before they see hundreds of C-130s and 141s taking off from Pope Air Force Base. Everyone knew where we were headed. And so CNN International filmed us taking off, and the de facto leader who had taken over the government unjustly capitulated, allowing our planes to turn around midair and to return home without ever having to fire a shot. Vice President Al Gore visited us 2 days later, by the way, with a broken leg, and was quoted as saying, "When America cares to send the very best, we send for the 82nd Airborne." Probably one of the greatest quotes from any former politician ever. Now, my winter storm happened to make the cover of Time magazine, but your storm may not. It doesn't make it any less valuable or important. And as we look back at this great passage of Scripture, it says that there is time for everything under heaven. And we say heaven and not under the sun because it gives it more of a divine focus, that God is in control of all of the seasons, and he's also in control of all of our seasons. He is in control. There is a great lesson that stands out to me, and I like the way that Solomon puts the word silent before speak. He says there's a time to be silent, and there's a time to speak. What a great lesson for us, to be silent and to listen before we respond. And a response is different than a reaction. They're called first responders for a reason. They're prepared and they are calm in the moment of crisis. Whereas reactions are emotional, and we tend to react to situations rather than respond. And I encourage you to allow the emotions to calm down. And if you need to, step away from the conversation. My husband and I know all too well about that. But stepping away from an emotional moment so that we both can take a breath. Because how many times do we say things in that heat of the moment that we will regret forever? It also says there's a time to kill. Now, my 1994 experience is different than maybe an experience you're dealing with. And what we're talking about here isn't just about an actual kill, it's about a relationship that may need to die. One that is unhealthy, one that is not good for you. Are you holding on to those kind of toxic relationships? You are who you associate yourself with. Last week we talked about you are what you eat. Well, it also is what you associate yourself with. If you surround yourself with toxic people, those traits will rub off on you. So you've got to make sure you remove those kind of relationships out of your life that are not healthy. If people don't have your best interests in mind, then maybe they aren't the kind of people that you need to be associated with. And by the way, not all friendships are meant to last a lifetime. There are what we call summer relationships. There are shorter relationships. How many of you as a kid went off to youth camp or band camp or theater camp? Well, I did too. And we would go across the country and we'd meet these kids from around the country. And we'd have this week where all we would do is like sing praise and worship and get preached at. And I do mean preached at, not to. And at the end of the week, we'd sing, "Friends are friends forever." If the Lord is the Lord of them, I'm going to love you forever. I'm going to write you even though you live five states away and I don't even know your last name. Only to get back and not ever think of that person again. It's okay. Hey, the people that I stood in that plane with 27 years ago, I only speak to one or two of them today. So let's dive right in. What season are you in right now? There are four. The first is the season of fall. The season of fall is described as success and achievement and sometimes failure. We need to thank God for the good times and success in life. How often do we only turn to God when the storms begin to gather? Praise Him in the good times. Praise Him in the prosperity. Praise Him in the moments of success. You know, every time we take off, I ask the Lord's Prayer to protect that plane, and I travel 40 weeks a year. I travel a lot. People think I'm a flight attendant. And every time we land, I also say, thank you, Lord, for getting us here safely. And I am scared if I forget and we're taking off and then I start to pray. I always try to pray when we're on the tarmac before we're moving because I feel like it carries more weight. And listen, you're going to fail in this season too. If you fail, fail forward. The season in our life allows us the opportunity to fail. My husband and I had a very heated discussion last night about this season of failure. And sometimes failure is not an option for some people. And we need to consider that. Financially, you put everything forward, and sometimes it doesn't work out. What do you do next? So I understand that not all failure is created equal in this scenario. See, I got it in there, honey. That's my best friend, so of course I've got to, and my husband. But failure is an opportunity for us to step back and to take a measurement and a course correction in our life of what we need to do differently. In my world as a leader and as a coach of people, I use what we call pluses and deltas. And I'm sure other leaders have heard this statement before. Pluses are words of confirmation. You tell them the things you're doing really well. And instead of like adding a negative in there, we call them deltas. Deltas is Greek for course correction, which is a reason why I fly American. The rest of you will get that joke on the way home. But it is a course correction. So how many times have you had a manager or a boss or a leader say, you know, you did a great job with this, but, you know, when you say the word but, you have completely negated the first half of that sentence. Instead, you did this very well. And next time we approach this, perhaps we could do this. You see how that changes the context of the way we turn that from a negative into a course correction. And remember that failure is never final, except when you're horizontal. When you're dead, failure is final. But until then, you can always get back up. You can always try again. It may be a setback, and it may be a challenging time. And by the way, you don't immediately jump back after a failure. It takes time, and there's a process there too. In my life, I was fired from a major network as a TV executive, or as I prefer to call it, promoted to viewer. That was a devastating moment in my life. And it was a devastating moment for a lot of different reasons, but first of all, I had allowed my job to define who I was. All of my success, all of my adoration that had been thrown on me was because of how good I was at what I did. When you allow your work to define you, what happens when that work is gone? Piece of you dies and you lose your identity. So create a balance between the work you do and your personal life. Not only did I allow my identity to be tied completely to my job, but I was reading my own press. What that means is I was believing everything people were telling me about how great I was. And no one said no to me. I didn't know why. And until you realize that you start believing your own press, you think you're invincible and you think you're not replaceable. Well, let me be very clear today. We're all replaceable. Somebody will do it faster, smarter, better, wiser from someone else's perspective. So keep yourself humble and remember every day where you are. And today, I have the best job I've ever imagined I would ever have. And it is the sum of all the experiences, both good and bad, that led me up to the opportunity to do what I do today. And I travel because I love being with my people and I love being with my stations and with my advertisers and helping local businesses grow and thrive in their communities. That's the reward. But all of that led up from a failure and a firing that forced me to take control of me. And today I feel that I'm better, stronger, and thank God, wiser. Now you could possibly be in a season of summer. We're just ending our summer. This is a season of a sign of growth, but there's also need for protection and there's abundance of distractions. How true is that of summer? How many times you look out the window and you go, why am I sitting in an office when it's as gorgeous as it is? Of course, unless you've been here for the last couple of months and you're like, thank God I'm in air conditioning. Very hot. But this season also comes with storms. We just saw it this week. Unexpected storms and storms that we know are coming even though people aren't quite prepared when they do. Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina all dealing with that right now. Michael and Mitchell dealt with that in San Diego. They brought all their lawn furniture inside. Thank the Lord. Can't replace that. But the summer is hot here in Texas, and I'm reminded of another hot situation. In Daniel chapter 4, remember the story of Daniel and Daniel and the fiery furnace? Well, let me take you back. I'm not going to read the whole scripture to you, but I'll just give you the Reader's Digest version. King Nebuchadnezzar, what a great name, King Nebuchadnezzar, the second. So there were two of them. He was king of Babylon. We're going to hear a lot about Babylon, by the way. They were exiled a lot. They were the nemesis of the children of Israel. They were thrown into this furnace because they refused to bow down to their king and the God that he had created. And so he commanded them to be bound up, these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and thrown into this furnace to be set an example of. And they did. They bound them, and as they were throwing them in, the very men who were throwing them in were consumed by the flames of the furnace. But miraculously, as the king looked down into the furnace, he didn't see three people. He saw four. And the Bible says the fourth was that of like a God figure. Now, some theologians believe it could have been God, it could have been Jesus, it could have been an angel. But someone was in there with them, protecting them, and they were literally walking around without being affected by the fire. Not a hair was singed, not a garment was scorched. And when they were pulled out, the king bowed down before them and said, I shall now worship this God who is more powerful than mine. And I want you to know that even in the heat of summer and the challenges, we don't face those challenges alone. Just like Daniel in the furnace, God is there with us to protect us. He was the fourth person in the furnace. And we don't face these battles alone. And I was reminded of a story of a little boy who was afraid to go out into the garage at night because the light switch was on the opposite side of the wall. And he went to his mother and says, "Mom, will you come with me outside? I'm afraid of the dark, and I don't want to take the trash out to the garage." By the way, I try to use that excuse with my husband. It doesn't work. But she says, "Son, don't you know that the Lord is with you and he'll be there to protect you?" And so the little boy walked out to the garage and he opened the door into the darkness and he said, "Lord, I know you're here. So will you just go ahead and get the light for me?" We joke, but keep in mind, Proverbs 18:24 tells us that we have a friend that is closer than a brother. Deuteronomy 31:8 says, "The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." We don't face these battles alone. The battle has already been won. There's a song out now on Christian radio. It says, "I'm fighting the battles you've already won." How many times are we battling the same battles? We just need to lean on God, who has already fought those battles, and he's going to give us the strength and the wisdom that we need to get through those. But also, let me remind you, don't allow others to create the storms in your life. We are who we choose to hang out with, as I said earlier. If you surround yourself with pot stirrers, you know who I'm talking about. These are the people who like to just stir it up, get people riled up against each other. These are not people who have your best interests in mind. Adam and I have a friend that creates a storm whenever he comes to Dallas, and we promise to rebuild after those storms. It is a hurricane when he comes. And it gets to the point where you have to ask yourself, why are we doing this? Is this healthy? But we still love him. But we keep those storms out of the house most of the time. Don't put yourself in a position where you're going to have to clean up after other people's mess. If they don't have enough respect for your peace and your warm and beautiful temperatures, then they don't deserve to be in your atmosphere. Remove those distractions in this summer months, and it'll make you appreciate the warmer weather when those storms pass. Perhaps you're in a season of spring. This is my favorite season. It is of hope and new beginnings and opportunities. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here." Now, this particular season is often connected with those who have first come into a relationship with Jesus Christ, but it is not only for those who have first come to the relationship. While Jesus has exchanged your life for his own to pay the price of sin in our life, he allows us to have these spring-like moments throughout our life. Because remember, spring comes more than once. And the beauty of that spring is that sometimes when the storms begin to gather, and maybe you can relate to this, have you ever read a scripture you've read probably 15 other times in your life, but in a moment or a season, all of a sudden it took on a different meaning, a different context? That's not coincidence. That's the Spirit of God through those words of encouragement. So allow yourself to have those spring seasons, because those, and really appreciate them, because when they change, it can be devastating. And finally, the most difficult season of all is the season of winter. It includes sadness and heartbreak, loneliness and sickness. This is the most dreadful season of them all. Nothing really prepares you for a spiritual winter season. I remember sitting with our pastor in 2014 after I'd been promoted to viewer. I couldn't find a job anywhere in Dallas. And so I had to move 15 hours away in 4 states to find a job in television. And I remember asking our pastor at that moment, I said, why is this happening? Why have I finally found a church that I love and a pastor that I love only to be moved into this other place in this season? And she was very insightful with her response. She says, sometimes God prepares you for the next season. You see, the season that I was stepping out of was the first time I had stepped back into a church after being an ordained minister of the Southern Baptist Convention. I had left church when I had met my husband, and I swore I would never go back again, because when I came out, the church turned its back on me. And I said, well, fine, then I will turn my back on it. And it wasn't until we in 2014 or 2013 found this church and our pastor, and we found comfort in that place. But God was preparing me for the season that I would go into next. And I appreciate that more now today than I ever have. And so there's a couple of things we need to be prepared for in this winter season. Some things we should be asking ourselves. What can I learn from this season in life? What is God trying to teach us through these difficult times? Is it patience? Is it understanding? Is it acceptance? It is in these moments that we have to lean on our faith. And remember, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And so we're forced to use our faith to see our distance. It's also admitting and accepting our discrepancies. We have to take stock and own our own mistakes and accept them. And that was tough for me to do, because I didn't want to dig in and know that. And I was forced to become a better leader from those opportunities of learning. Jeff Foxworthy, in one of his stand-ups a couple years ago, says, I used to love watching Oprah, except when they had those kids on talking about their parents. He goes, they all got on there and they said, my parents are terrible and they never loved me and they never took care of me. He says, just once I wanted one of these kids to say, I'm an idiot. I'm a moron. My parents were saints and I squandered everything they gave me. But we live in a generation, we live in a world that does not want to take responsibility. We want to point the finger. And as my mother used to tell me every time I pointed a finger, you've got three more pointing right back at you. You're all going to go home and do that. And it's true. It's us taking responsibility for our actions so that we can be better. Next, stop looking in the past. Quit trying to relive that history and mistakes, the past wrongs and the past hurts, the past mistakes, the past decisions. Dwelling in the past will only make you feel worse. Instead, focus on the future. As Shante spoke last week, we all have to find our purpose, and she feels her calling is to help others find their purpose, which I think is a great calling. And I don't know what God has in store for you. I don't have access to God's vision for your life. But I can tell you in Jeremiah 29, 11 through 14, and you'll be familiar with the first verse, but I wanted to give you full context here. It says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and hope. And that's usually where we kind of stop that, because it's such a sweet, kind. But let me give you context. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me. And when you seek me with all your heart, I don't like that he says all your heart, not passively seek me, but diligently seek me with your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord. I will restore your fortunes. This doesn't necessarily mean money, but the goodness of your life, the joy in your life. And then I will gather you from all the nations and all the places that you have been driven, declares the Lord. I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. Oh, these people of the Old Testament, Jeremiah, guess who had defeated them again? Babylon. Boy, those Babylonians. Every time you turn around, right there. But they were in a place of exile. They were in a foreign land, in an enemy territory. And perhaps you're feeling exiled today. Perhaps you're exiled from family members, from loved ones, from people you work with. Whatever those exiles are that you're living with, know that God wants us to flourish where you are. He has plans for the future, but he also has plans for right now. And do you know what he tells the people who are exiled into this foreign land? He says, build your homes, plant your seeds, plant your gardens, get married. I want you to create a good life, even though you're not in the place you want to be. Today, we would say, grow where you're planted. My husband is a horticulturist. In other words, we have a lot of plants. And when I say a lot, I don't mean a few. I'm saying it's a jungle at our house. And when the seasons change, Adam has these pop-up greenhouses, and I think we're up to like 47. Not that quite many, but a lot. And in one particular winter, February 2021, everyone remember February 2021? We had just come out of 2020 and COVID, and 2021 says, hold my beer. Adam saw that we were going to have the worst storm in 100 years, and so Adam made an executive decision. Any purchase in our home, anything over $500, we're supposed to consult with each other. This rule was really created because I kept buying flat screen TVs bigger and bigger every year. And Adam's like, really? Now we have an 85-inch in our living room. It's like a theater. It's ridiculous. By the way, I don't need to wear my glasses when I watch TV at night. Not on that TV. So he'd made an executive decision to buy this generator. I was furious. Look at how happy he is. Well, I ate my words in the very next picture. As we woke up the next morning to no power in our house, and that would go on for days, Adam's research and diligent studying paid off for once. He knew I was going to say that. Love you, honey. But I also remember having Ron and Louise come to our house and stay with us as we all battled. And Adam reminded me, by the way, I love candles. So if you ever want to gift me something, give me a candle. I can never have too many candles. How many like candles? Well, yeah. Soothing, aren't they? Wonderful. So we had 4 million candles stocked up in time, so we had plenty of candles. And by the way, it actually does provide warmth when there are 72 going in a room. Could be dangerous, but you know. And so as this storm kept battling in at us, we'd have to go out every couple hours and run the generator and refill the generator. And we, every time we filled it up with gas, Adam and I were running out to find a gas station to fill it out. Well, the gas station started running out of gas and propane, because those are the two things that we were using in the greenhouses and to heat our home. Again, the generator was outside, not inside. But we had these cords running into the house, keeping a couple of appliances and things on. Well, I noticed that there was this one cord running away from the house toward a greenhouse. And I start pulling up the cord, and I'm like, well, well, well. He is still keeping these greenhouses warm, and we're barely staying warm in the house. I don't care how many palm trees are in there. So I made an executive decision. Unplugged it and ran it back into the house. Sometimes the winter storms can draw you closer to the ones you love. When Adam was diagnosed with stage 3 non-Hodgkin's lymphoma cancer in August of 2017, we thought our world was crashing down. I've often heard that we were all just one phone call from our knees. That devastating call that changes everything in your life. Through that battle, Adam and I would bicker and fight about the most ridiculous things. And so we stopped fighting over the things that didn't matter. And today, I can honestly say Adam and I have not had a fight since January of 2018. I mean a real fight. We have heated discussions and conversations. He's usually right and I'm wrong, and usually that's how it goes. If you're married, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But we don't fight over who put the dishes in the dishwasher right or wrong, and we all know there's a right way and a wrong way. We decided that life was too precious to waste it over the things that just don't matter. And so we decided when he was fighting cancer, our mantra was, we don't fight each other, we fight the cancer. And we've kept that mantra ever since. It was also in that moment that Adam and I saw the humanity in others, an outpouring of love and support from friends and family in this very church that we will never forget. So when we talk about the power of prayer, the power of prayer is a real thing. And my husband is healed today by the amazing physicians and doctors who studied years to prepare, but also because of the hand of God and the prayer of the people we love the most, our people. Sometimes the storms, the winter storms of life, also show you who your true friends are. Shantae and I have faced some battles in our days. Our pastor was there when my father passed away. She was also there the day I said goodbye to my mother. And even in that moment, some of my family had turned their back and forced Adam and I to sit in the back of the church, not even with our family, on that day. But my pastor was there. Danny Hall was there. Ron and Louise were there. My chosen family was there. And that's what mattered. That's what mattered to me. And when Adam was sick, Ron was the first to raise his hand and says, how can I help? Can I MC an event to help you raise awareness and support for Adam? These demonstrations of love in the midst of the storm show you who your friends are. Maya Angelou famously said, when people show you who they are, believe them. They are doing you a favor. True friends are there no matter what. And I jokingly say they're also the ones who are there on moving day. See, the band's already here. But I want to end by telling a quick story about a man who knew a lot about challenges in his life. A gentleman by the name of Horatio Stafford. He was a devout Christian, and he was a member of D.L. Moody's church. You know, D.L. Moody was a preacher in the late 1800s, a Presbyterian preacher. And around the same time that the Chicago fire, which destroyed this banker and investor's entire life, lost in the Chicago fire of 1871, a few months later, he also lost his four-year-old son to scarlet fever. Thinking a vacation would be a great opportunity to get his daughters and his wife and him away from Chicago, they decided to book a cruise to London. And his four daughters and wife had loaded the ship, but he had to stay behind to finish some business and would join them on the next trip. Halfway on that passage across the Atlantic Ocean, their ship collided with another ship, and both sunk within 15 minutes. 200 souls were lost in that shipwreck, including all four of Horatio's daughters. The only one saved was his wife, and she wired back when she reached England, saved alone, what shall I do? Horatio immediately set sail for England, and at the point where they had reached the place where the two ships had collided and had sunk, The captain brought him to the deck. He says, I thought you might want to know that this is where your daughter's bodies are, some 3 miles beneath us. And while he could have been angry and he was emotional, instead he was overwhelmed knowing that while his daughters laid in a watery grave at the bottom of the ocean, they were in the hands of God. And so he grabbed a piece of paper with tears in his eyes, and he wrote these words: when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to know, it is well with my soul. Remember the picture I showed you of me in the snow? Here is what happened a few months later. The sun came out, the snow melted, the seasons changed, and the beautiful garden came back to life. Whatever season you are in, know a season will change. If you're living in a winter, know that spring and summer are on the way. But I hope, regardless of what season you're in, may be reminded of the words of Horatio, that it is well with my soul.